Yeah, every time we decided to support a new console, whether it was the 2600 to begin with or the NES, there's a tremendous amount of back-end work that you have to do. You need to create a development system that is a piece of hardware that connects to the NES, for example, and lets you download data into memory that is then played, lets you modify the memory, breakpoints, and breakpoints to test your code, hook up a logic analyzer if necessary. It's all this stuff you have to do hardware-wise to make, to be able to make software in the first place. And then, you're limited by the size of the ROM every single time. I mean, there's a truism in video games. You know, they say, do you want it fast, do you want it cheap, or do you want it good? Well, you can add to that if you want it to fit the ROM. You know, and you never have enough space. It's never a big enough ROM for what you want to do. So, you know, we're writing custom image compressors, we're writing all kinds of strange things that we had to do just to make those games work. And the next console comes out, now it's the Super Nintendo, we got to start all over again, do every one of those things again.
So it's not you go out and there's a dev kit or whatever, I don't even know, I'm not a software.
Today, yes. Today, you know, that person doesn't, company doesn't put out a console unless they put out an SDK that you can run, you know, because they know that everything is third-party software now. In the Nintendo days, my company, Absolute Entertainment, which I was another co-founder, partner Gary Kitchen, we created our own development system, and we made it really neat. So instead of just being this box that sits on the desk back in the lab, it was something that we could sell. And we ended up selling, I don't know, 50 of them, something like that.
Really?
Everybody else. So, and then all of a sudden, Nintendo said, holy cow, you sent 50 of those things for $20,000 a piece? We're going to do that.
So hardware and software, you guys.
So they said, you're no longer authorized to sell development systems for the NES. We're doing it. Well, yeah, I was brought in late stage of a device called the ISIX box or NEMO box, which, look it up, there may be some information online about it. It was basically a brilliant device that sat between your VCR and your television set, and you'd plug a cassette tape into your VCR and hit play. First thing it would do is download a program to the box, and then it would run a stream of full motion video. And the box was able to interpret that video in such a way as to make what looked like multi-channel switching video. Night Trap, you could press a button and you could watch the action in the kitchen. And then people walked out of the kitchen, and you could push the button in the living room and see them walk in, and there they are, and they're dancing and whatever. It was, you know, it was a B-horror movie with scantily clad women, as they put in those movies, getting eaten by vampires. And so that box was an amazing piece of technology. Take an ordinary video, VHS videotape, and plug it in, and you get interactive video on the other end. That product never made it to market, unfortunately. It was being done at a time when dynamic RAMs were, there was a shortage worldwide, and the dynamic RAMs tripled in price. And this was very RAM intensive, this box. And it was funded by Hasbro, and basically we said, all right, here's the box, and you know, it's going to be a wholesale price of about $100. You can sell it for $200 something to Toys R Us. And at that price, Toys R Us said, we'll take them all. And then the DRAM crisis hit, and had to go back and say, look, I'm sorry, but it's going to be $170 for this box now. Which means you have to sell it at $330, and Toys R Us said, we can't sell a $330 toy. We'll take everything you can make, give it to us for $100. We can't take, we won't take any of it at $170. Hasbro just closed down the company. There was no way to make it happen that year. All the design materials for Night Trap, all the video that was shot, and that in Sewer Shark, were then picked up and made in CD-ROM form on Sega CD by a company called Digital Pictures. And I'm credited on that